You are listening to Daily Bread Devotions with Father Eustace Yame, a Salesian of Don Bosco. Your word, Lord, is a lamp for my steps. Stay tuned.
This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word, spoken to me.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
It is Tuesday, the 2nd of August, 2022. 18th week in ordinary time, and participating in the proclamation of the word of God for today are the following Daily Bread members. Nchimunya Mainza, celebrating her birthday today from over Sweden, takes for us the first reading. Yvonne Semba Mulopachileshe from Brussels, Belgium, celebrating her golden birthday today, together with her husband, take for us the responsorial psalm. And proclaiming the gospel is Father Fidelis Betungula, celebrating his birthday today from Mbarara Archdiocese, Uganda. Let us pray. Draw near to your servants, O Lord, and answer their prayers with unceasing kindness, that for those who glory in you as their creator and guide, you may restore what you have created and keep safe what you have restored. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen.
The first reading. Because your sins are flagrant, I have done these things to you. I will restore the tents of Jacob. A reading from the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah 30, verse 1 to 2, 12 to 15, and 18 to 22. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel. Write in a book all the words that I have spoken to you. For thus says the Lord, your hurt is incurable, and your wound is grievous. There is none to uphold your cause. No medicine for your wound, no healing for you. All your lovers have forgotten you. They care nothing for you, for I have dealt you the blow of an enemy. The punishment of a merciless foe. Because your guilt is great, because your sins are flagrant. Why do you cry out over your head? Your pain is incurable. Because your guilt is great, because your sins are flagrant. I have done these things to you. Thus says the Lord. Behold, I will restore the fortunes of the tents of Jacob, and have compassion on his dwellings. The city shall be rebuilt upon its mound, and the palace shall stand where it used to be. Out of them shall come songs of thanksgiving, and the voices of those who make merry. I will multiply them, and they shall not be few. I will make them honored, and they shall not be small. Their children shall be as they were of old, and their congregation shall be established before me, and I will punish all who oppress them. Their prince shall be one of themselves. Their ruler shall come forth from their midst. I will make him draw near, and he shall approach me. For who would dare of himself to approach me, says the Lord. And you shall be my people, and I will be your God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The responsorial psalm is taken from Psalm 102, verses 16 to 18, 19 to 21, 29, and 22 to 23. Response is taken from Psalm 102, verse 17. And the response is, the Lord shall build up Zion, he will appear in all his glory. The Lord shall build up Zion, he will appear in all his glory. The nations shall fear the name of the Lord, and all the earth's kings your glory. When the Lord shall build up Zion, He will turn to the prayers of the helpless. He will not despise their prayers. The Lord shall build up Zion. He will appear in all his glory. Let this be written for ages to come, that a people yet unborn may praise the Lord. The Lord looked down from heaven to the earth to hear the groans of the prisoners and free those condemned to die. The Lord shall build up Zion. He will appear in all his glory. The children of your servants shall dwell untroubled, and their descendants established before you. May the name of the Lord be proclaimed in Zion, and his praise in Jerusalem. When peoples and kingdoms are gathered as one to offer their worship to the Lord. The Lord shall build up Zion. He will appear in all his glory.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Chapter 14, verses 22 to 36. After the crowd ate and were satisfied, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat by this time was many furlongs distant from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night he came to them, walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost," and they cried out for fear. But immediately he spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I, have no fear." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, bid me come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "O you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." And when they had crossed over, they came to the land at Gennesaret. And when the men of that place recognized him, they sent round all that region and brought him all that were sick, and begged him that they might only touch the fringe of his garment. And as many as touched it, we are made well. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We have now started looking at the consoling part of the book of Jeremiah, Prophet Jeremiah. It is chapter 30, which is made up of oracles of the restoration of Israel and Judah. This is more in the form of our good night messages. Jeremiah, who has been very tough and rough on his own people, now becomes consoling. This is what we call the Book of Consolation, that consists of chapter 30 to chapter 33. Very consoling passages. And he is doing this because the people of Israel are in exile and they are in great distress. Somebody must give them a word of comfort, a word of consolation. So what we have is a promise of restoration for the people of Israel. It will take some time, but it will happen. And we see this change of tone. God entering into the shoes of his own people. "For thus says the Lord, your hurt is incurable, and your wound is grievous. There is none to uphold your cause, no medicine for your wound, no healing for you." I understand, God wants to say, "I feel with you. I know what you have been going through. I know how distressed you have been. But I am promising one thing. Behold, I will restore the fortunes of the tents of Jacob and have compassion on his dwellings. This is the promise of God. God is going to show his compassion. He's going to feel with us. He knows how incurable is our wound. He knows how the economy is biting. He has entered into our shoes. He has become one of us. He knows how difficult it is to manage family life. He knows how difficult it is to manage our finances because our salaries don't match with our expenses. He understands that. He understands our day-to-day struggles. And he's coming into our shoes to help us come out of these things, to help us handle all that we go through. He's able to do it, and all he wants is our recognition of the fact that God is in our midst and he is going to work on things that seem to trouble us. Look at the gospel passage of today. Jesus, after feeding the thousands and letting the people go, he also made the disciples get into the boat to go to the other side. And they went alone. He remained on an elevated place, on a mountain praying, that is heaven. He remained there in heaven. It is a story connected to the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. When we read some of these things, we have to understand that some of these stories are connected to a life after the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's already up in heaven with his dad and he's watching over his disciples and how they are struggling. The way the people of Israel were struggling in exile, God was able to feel with them because of his compassion. So also he did that to the disciples, struggling with the winds of the sea, being beaten by the waves, which represent the persecutions that the believers went through. Those waves represent those persecutions that made the disciples to start feeling God had left them alone. But they were not left alone. He was with them. And he was still indicating that he is victorious. He has overcome the forces of the sea, is able to walk on water. And he comes to their direction, and they are afraid because they felt they were seeing a ghost. These people who had been on the sea at night, and they were able to do fishing, there were four fishermen there, clearly known. The sons of Zebedee, Andrew and Peter. These are professional fishermen, and they were able to be afraid. Despite their expertise, they had something to fear. And the Lord said, "It is I, do not be afraid. It is I." Now look at Peter. Peter saying, "If it is you, Lord, demand that I come to you. If it is you." Peter had doubts even then. In that moment of fear, in that moment of struggle, doubt comes to everyone. Peter is afraid. Peter is struggling. And here is where faith is demanded. It is I. Do not be afraid. Okay, if it is you, let me come where you are. Okay, Lord, if it is you, allow me to believe that this cancer will be handled well. Okay, Lord, if it is you, allow me to step into this marriage, to continue working on this troubled marriage. Oh, Lord, yes, if it is you, allow me to come your side. Despite the challenges I am facing in my finances, despite the challenges I am facing with my diabetes, despite the challenges I am facing with my cancer, despite the challenges I am facing with rheumatism, despite the challenges I am facing with my friends and family, let me come where you are. He dared. At least he dared. The other disciples were afraid. The other disciples were cowards. Let us not think that Peter was a coward here. No, those who did not dare to check their level of faith were the ones who were cowards. They should all have come out of the boat. It is only Peter who did. Yes, he didn't manage. He started drowning. And I suppose the other disciples were even laughing. Oh, look at him. He thought he could walk on water like our Lord. And here he is drowning. But others prayed for him. Others prayed that the Lord may come to his aid to take him out. We look at the priests who dare to walk on water. We look at the pastors who dare to walk on water. We look at the sisters and all those committed to God who dare to walk on water. We look at people who get into marriage daring to walk on water. And we start laughing at them when things start going wrong. At least they dare to commit themselves to something. Why laugh at them? Come on. I'm happy they know where to cry to the God who takes them out of their drowning situation. And this God, we must continue seeking to take us out of that drowning situation. Lord, save me, for I'm drowning. And he will take us out of that. We give glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed Tuesday to you.
Thanks be to God.
This is my daily bread. Your very word, spoken to me. And I'm desperate for you. And I'm lost without you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day. Your bed.